want to talk about what does it mean if we don't remain? What is this idea of being cut off and thrown into the fire? Does that mean we can lose our salvation? Imagine going to a store tomorrow and trying to buy your favorite treat with a $20 bill with only one side. You think the cash register would take that from you, the register lady? No. She'd say, you're not getting anything with this. You need to have a double-sided, two-sided. For it to be real, it has to have both sides. This is such a problem for most of us. We have a one-sided God. People say, my God is a God of mercy. My God is a God of love. Yes, he is, but he's also a God of wrath and a God of judgment and a God who hates evil and he hates sin. There's a two-sided God. Okay, welcome to day number 3 of the 31-day John 7:17 challenge. We're just getting started, just getting warmed up. Just want to warn you in advance, today's video is going to be a standalone on one teaching, teaching number 7. And the reason is it's a long one. We cannot cover this teaching without having the question, can I lose my salvation, come up? I'm going to do the best I can to explain to you what I really believe the Bible says. I'm going to show it to you, and then I'm going to provide for you a document at the bottom of this video. You can download a link, and that will provide for you all of the scriptures that I took the time to research and compile on answering this question, can a person lose their salvation? It's something critical that we need to know, and I tell you, there are really good teachers on both sides of the fence. So before you already decide you've made your mind up about this, even if you've been in church 30 years, I want you to know there is a huge divide on this question. There are great teachers, great men of God on both sides of this that I personally follow and listen to and have benefited from that are directly opposed to each other on this subject. So I'm going to tell you that I spent hundreds of hours studying this subject. I've put some scriptures together for you, we're going to get into this. We'll cover the additional teachings 8 and 9 tomorrow. Let's go ahead and get into this scripture and dive in and see what we can find. Number 7, John 15:5-7. Remain in Christ through obedience to his words, and you will bear fruit and not be cut off. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me, and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be given you. Okay, let's go on the treasure hunt and see if we can answer these questions. I am the vine, you are the branches. This is the key to understanding the Christian life right here. This is one of the most important passages of Scripture as it relates to solving the big challenge of how do I live this Christian life successfully. So many people burn themselves out and exhaust themselves trying to live more righteously or produce more fruit or do more good deeds. They exhaust themselves and they cannot live the Christian life. The truth is, you cannot live the Christian life apart from the Spirit of Jesus Christ. It sounds almost ethereal when I say that. It almost sounds like, wow, that makes sense, but what does that sound like practically? I want to try to help you understand, what does that mean when somebody says you can't live the Christian life on your own? Let's take a look at the passage and see if we can answer this. Okay, so I'm the vine, you're the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him. Now notice the words if. Three ifs, conditions we need to pay attention to. If this, then this, all right? If a man remains in me and I in him. This is our main responsibility as a Christian, is to remain in Jesus Christ, not to get busy apart from him, trying to do good works and do all these things and become a better super mini Jesus. No, we are supposed to be remaining in him. So what does that mean? We're going to get to there. Watch. He, this person who remains in him, will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me. Again, Jesus is making it very clear. It's possible for you and I to be Christians and not remain in him. How is that possible? What does that mean? He is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. What does that mean? Well, John says that Jesus Christ was coming with a winnowing fork in his hand, prepared to separate wheat from chaff and to throw the chaff into unquenchable fire. What's that fire? We don't like it, but it's the fire of hell. This is that hell, fire, and damnation preaching that gets so many people in trouble, but it's the truth. I beg you to just hear the truth. Just because we want to put our head in the sand doesn't mean that the truth decides to run away or it's no longer the truth because we're not going to look at it. It's the truth, and it will cost us if we don't look at it. Okay, so he says, if you remain in, the question we need to ask is how? Well, we learned that answer yesterday where Jesus says, if you obey my commands, you will remain in my love. So again, it's all coming back to Jesus's words remaining in you. Then he says, ask whatever you wish and it will be given you. So now Jesus is tying obedience to his words also to having prayers answered. Okay, so how do we literally remain in Jesus Christ? If this is our main responsibility, how do we do it? What's it look like practically? Here it is. We have faith. We believe that what he says is true. God has enabled us by his grace to believe that Jesus is Lord. We don't just believe in him intellectually. It'd be like saying, hey, I believe my boss is existing, but I'm not getting a paycheck. I can't figure it out. Well, it's because we're not doing what he says to do. Nobody would expect to just believe in their boss and get a paycheck. No, you have to believe also in his words. So we have to believe in his words, believe Jesus is Lord through faith. Number two, we have to surrender our will to his. What is it, anything, anybody, any goals, any dreams, any desires, any hangups, we need to surrender, not my will be done, but your will be done in order to remain in Jesus Christ. We also need to obey his words. That's what Jesus is teaching us here. And number four, we'll get into this later, total childlike dependence. We depend upon God for everything. Lord, please help me to get this video done today. Please speak through me, Holy Spirit. I do not show up in front of this camera without depending upon God. I don't walk into a Starbucks without saying, Lord, please bring somebody across my path today. I don't walk up on the mountain saying, Lord, I know you've called me up here today. I've got this. No, Lord, by the power of your Spirit, give me discernment, Lord, to know what this person's going through so that I can speak the words they need to hear to be blessed of you today. Depending upon God, you know that I need finances. God, please bless me with book sales. God, please bless me with more fruit. I'm praying and depending upon God. That's how we remain in Jesus Christ. Now, if I did all those things and I failed to forgive somebody, I'm not remaining in Jesus Christ. If I don't, if I resist an evil person and I treat somebody back the way they treated me, then I'm not remaining in Jesus Christ. You see how quick it is? We can be in or out. Now, here's what we want to talk about. We want to talk about what does it mean if we don't remain? What is this idea of being cut off and thrown into the fire? Does that mean we can lose our salvation? Let me address this with you. I want to show you a couple of scriptures, and then I'm going to give you what I believe the Bible's clearest explanation is on answering this question. Let's take a look at these scriptures. These are just a couple I want to show you now. I have about 80 of these scriptures that I have collected and put into a document for you. But if a righteous man turns from his righteousness and commits sin, and does the same detestable things the wicked man does, will he live? None of the righteous things he's done will be remembered. Because of the unfaithfulness he is guilty of, and because of the sins he has committed, he will die. So right here, God is saying to us, this is God speaking in the book of Ezekiel, saying to us that if we turn from the path of righteousness, we will die. Some say, well, this is Old Testament. I'm going to show you why it's not in just a few minutes. But here's the key point. If you and I come to Christ, however you came to Christ, whether it was a moment, a decision at a church, or over a period of time, you began to believe in Jesus Christ and began to obey his words and read the Bible. If you come to Jesus Christ and you get forgiven of all of your past sins because you recognize that's why you came to him to begin with, because you're doomed and condemned to hell just like I was and just like every person born on this planet is, without the saving grace and the work of him shedding his blood on that cross, I came to him for forgiveness. You come to him for forgiveness. If I turn around and go roll in the mud, am I to count myself as saved? Am I to count myself as somebody who God will look at and say, I'm going to welcome you into heaven? Or am I not turning away from righteousness and going right back to wickedness? Let's keep watching. In Romans 11:21, this is where Paul is talking about how Jews were cut off and Gentiles were grafted in. And he says, if some of the branches have been broken off and you, though a wild olive shoot, have been grafted in among the others and now share in the nourishing sap, the Holy Spirit from the olive root. Do not boast over those branches, meaning the Jews. If you do, consider this. You do not support the root, but the root supports you. You will say then, branches were broken off so that I could be grafted in. Granted, but they were broken off because of unbelief, and you stand by faith. Do not be arrogant, but be afraid. When's the last time you heard that preached? For if God did not spare the natural branches, he will not spare you either. Now watch this. Imagine going to a store tomorrow and trying to buy your favorite treat with a $20 bill with only one side. You think the cash register would take that from you, the register lady? No. She'd say, you're not getting anything with this. You need to have a double-sided, two-sided. For it to be real, it has to have both sides. This is such a problem for most of us. We have a one-sided God. People say, my God is a God of mercy. My God is a God of love. Yes, he is, but he's also a God of wrath and a God of judgment and a God who hates evil and he hates sin. There's a two-sided God. Consider, therefore, the kindness and sternness of God, sternness to those who fell, but kindness to you, provided that you continue in his kindness. Otherwise, you also will be cut off. Well, what passage of scripture did we just look at? That any branch that does not remain in him is like a branch that withers. Such branches are picked up and thrown into the fire and burned. I want you to begin asking yourself this question. Have you been taught that you cannot ever lose your salvation and that because you prayed some prayer in a church or raised your hand and came to an altar call that you're in scot-free and nothing can ever affect your ability to get into heaven? My friend, that is something that the Bible does not teach. Keep watching. 1 John 2:24, see that what you have heard from the beginning remains in you. Who does this sound like? Jesus. If it does, you also will remain in the Son and in the Father. What's the reciprocal? If what you heard from the beginning does not remain in you, you will not remain in the Son and in the Father. Okay, take a look at this passage in 2 Peter 2:20. If they have escaped the corruption, that's us, of the world, by knowing our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and are again entangled in it and overcome, they are worse off at the end than they were at the beginning. It would have been better for them to not have known the way of righteousness. These are people who've been, quote, saved, than to have known it and then to turn their backs on the sacred command that was passed on to them. Of them, the Proverbs are true. A dog returns to its vomit, and a sow that is washed goes back to her wallowing in the mud. Okay, this scripture clearly points out that there are people who knew Jesus Christ and they knew the way of righteousness and they turned from it. A non-believer cannot know Christ and cannot know the way of righteousness. So the question is, can a person lose their salvation? Well, in my own personal study, I discovered there's about three major positions on this question. There's the position of no, you absolutely cannot under any circumstances, if you've been sealed by the Holy Spirit, lose your salvation. There are good teachers who teach this. There are really good teachers as well that teach you absolutely can lose your salvation. Then there's a third position that says that if you fall away, you are never truly saved to begin with. Now, I want to pause for a second to tell you that I believe the biggest question that needs to be asked and the greatest area of concern is for Christians to find out 2 Corinthians 13:5 to examine themselves, to find out whether or not they are truly in the faith. If the Spirit of Christ is really in them, you will know if the Spirit of Christ. It is way beyond just having some an emotional experience or being able to cry when there's a good worship song going on. That has nothing to do, really, with the Spirit of Christ being in you. I tell people all the time, don't think because you can go to church and hear a good song and cry that the Spirit's moving, because I can take that whole worship band off, put Celine Dion right there, and make you cry the same exact way. There is more to it than this emotion stuff, okay? Yes, emotions are part of it, but there's a lot more to it than that. You've got to know, are you truly saved? If you're stuck in sin, if you're still rolling in the mud, the reality is you probably do not have the Spirit of Christ in you. But here is where I want you to know I stumbled. I began to conclude, I'd love to think, that a person cannot lose their salvation. But I began to see all of these warnings about not falling away. And I began to go, why would there be 80 warnings about falling away and holding to the hope that you had to begin with and holding to the confidence you had and enduring to the end and not walking away and not being deceived? Why would there be all these warnings in the Bible if it weren't possible for us to do so? I want you to look at a couple of other scriptures here. Look at this, 2 John 1:8, watch out that you do not lose what you have worked for, but that you may be rewarded fully. Anyone who runs ahead and does not continue in the teachings of Christ does not have God. Now let me just ask you a common sense question. If you do not have God or Jesus Christ, do you think you're going to be saved? I don't think so. Let's take a look at this. Anyone who does not have God, whoever continues in the teaching, has both the Father and the Son. If anyone comes to you and does not bring this teaching, do not take him into your house or welcome him. Anyone who welcomes him shares in his wicked work. That's why I'm bringing you this teaching, so that you can welcome me into your home. Just kidding. Let's take a look at another one. Look at this. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 27. Paul says, no, I beat my body and make it my slave so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. Now, if Paul thought he could be disqualified, the prize is salvation. The hope of glory is Jesus Christ coming back, resurrecting us from the dead. If Paul thought he could lose his, and he even at one point says, my brothers, don't be confused. I do not claim to have already taken hold of it. If he could lose it, and if he hasn't possessed it yet, what does that say about us? Let's go on. 1 Timothy 1:18, Timothy, my son, I give you this instruction in keeping with the prophecies once made about you, so that by following them, you may fight the good fight. If there's a fight, that indicates we could lose. Holding on to the faith and a good conscience, some have rejected these and so have shipwrecked their faith. Well, what does that imply? Let's take a look at another one. 1 Timothy 6:20 and 21, Timothy, guard what has been entrusted to your care. Turn away from godless chatter and the opposing ideas of what is falsely called knowledge, which some have professed and in so doing have wandered from the faith. Jesus Christ said, blessed is the man who does not fall away. If you fall away, you will not be saved. Nobody should expect that Billy Graham's original ministry partner is in heaven. He walked away. He became apostate. He claimed to be a believer of Jesus Christ and turned and walked away. I know nobody wants to hear this. I know it's not popular, but this is what the Bible teaches. Let's take a look at a couple others. Look at this, Hebrews chapter 2. We must pay more careful attention, therefore, to what we have heard so that we do not drift away. For if the message spoken by angels was binding and every violation and disobedience received its just punishment, how shall we escape if we ignore such a great salvation? And by the way, he's not talking about non-believers. He's talking to believers. He's writing this to the believers in the book of Hebrews. How shall we escape if we ignore such a great salvation? Warning us not to drift away. All right, another one. Hebrews 10:26, if we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. Anyone who rejected the law of Moses died without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much more severely do you think a man deserves to be punished who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, who has treated as an unholy thing the blood of the covenant that sanctified him? That's a person who's been saved, and who has insulted the Spirit of grace. For we know him who said, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, and again, the Lord will judge his people. It is a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. My friend, the evidence is overwhelming. If you read in the Bible and you believe what you read, instead of simply reading the parts that you believe, there's a huge difference. I have to ask you this question. Why are there so many warnings? I've only just shown you maybe 8. I'm about to show you, if you'll download the document, over 80 scriptures, 78 to 80, best I remember, that I found that are filled with warnings about you and I remaining in the faith and not falling away. So the question that we need to ask ourselves is, what would it mean if we fell away? If it were possible to fall away, what would it mean for us to fall away? I would love to believe that because Jesus Christ has placed his spirit inside of me, that I have been sealed and that I can never fall away. Watch this. Jesus says, nobody can take us out of his hands. But he never said that we can't remove ourselves. He never said that we couldn't be removed by our own neglect and lack of diligence or being distracted or not staying disciplined in our approach. If Jesus Christ flew us to the top of Mount Salvation and said, I've given you the ability to get here. You couldn't have got here on your own. There's nothing you could do to earn this. He gave it to us for free. But then he says, all you have to do, I've packed your bag, you have to stay here until I come back. If you choose to climb down, you choose to climb down. Jesus has never put in shackles on anybody's feet that I'm aware of and said, well, now that I've got you, I'm going to absolutely just make you a spiritual robot and you can never. No, there's still a devil who's threatening us. There still are temptations that come at us every day. There's still a world telling us life is like this. There's still all the worries and the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of wealth that's pulling at us every day. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who follow his precepts have good understanding. Psalm 111:10. My friend, I don't see any fear of the Lord before the eyes of very many Christians. And so I might ask myself, if you could never lose salvation, what would be the point of fearing the Lord? Why would Jesus have said, do not fear the one who can kill the body and after that do nothing to the soul? He says, fear the one who after the body is dead can throw both body and soul into hell. Why would Paul say to work out our salvation with fear and trembling? Why would he say, since we know what it is to fear the Lord, we try to persuade men? Why would he say, don't be arrogant, but be afraid? What's there to be afraid of if you just come to Jesus in an altar call or give some intellectual assent and your sign's still delivered? Go on about your business. You just no reason to fear. The reason to fear is because it's not as certain as people think. Now, again, I want to be clear. I don't walk around every day worried I'm going to lose my salvation. I don't walk around every day afraid of God. I walk around every day with a reverential fear. I have a deep love relationship with him, but I'm not so arrogant as to think that I couldn't somehow fall by choosing to. God has never made a spiritual robot that I'm aware of that just because he puts his spirit inside of you. I mean, think about this. Jesus didn't force his way into your heart by his spirit. Why would he force his way to stay there if you wanted him out? Why would he say, sorry, you don't have any choice in the matter. I've taken up residence. Now watch, if he's in you and you've experienced the fruit of the Spirit, you want him to stay in you. You want him to continue to take up residence. But that doesn't mean that he couldn't leave. I don't see any scripture evidence that he couldn't leave if you grieved him or quenched him long enough. Wow, Mike, I don't know about that. Well, think about a couple of scriptures Jesus taught. Jesus says, you are the salt of the earth. Okay? He says, but if salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be, what? Thrown out and trampled by men. He's saying to the disciples, you're the salt of the earth, but if you lose your saltiness, you'll be thrown out. What about in the parable Mark 2:22, the parable of the wineskins? No one pours new wine into old wineskins. That is Jesus Christ and his Spirit into the old wineskins of old religion or old ways. He says, if you do, the wine will burst the skins, the wine will run out, and the skins will be ruined. That's Jesus Christ, the Spirit of Christ, running out and being ruined. What about the trees that don't produce fruit and they're cut off? There's just way too much evidence that says somehow or another, it's somewhat mysterious, but somehow or another, you and I have to participate in this. We can't just cha-ching, get the stamp and we're done and move on with our life. We have to be diligent. That's why the Bible says, be very careful. Warnings, and you'll see all these scriptures, all these warnings about, be very careful to pay attention to all that you've heard. Hold on to everything. Hold on to your faith. Fight the good fight. He who overcomes will not be put to shame. Only hold on to what you have so that no one will take this. How could somebody take something from you? Why would Jesus say to the church who overcomes, I will surely not blot his name out of the book of life? Why would Jesus Christ say that he would do something that's not possible to do unless it were possible to do? I'm going to end this now. I thank you for your patience. I hope you're not frustrated. I hope this gives you something to think about. My friend, I'm already certain in what I know, and I'm going to stand before God and believe and be held accountable to everything I have, and I'm going to continue to learn as much as I can. But you need to know. You and I have got to be the ones that stand before God and know and give an account for why we believe what we believe. All right, I'm not going to beat this up anymore. I'll leave it with this. I pray that you'll spend some time and go through these teachings and decide for yourself, what does the Bible say that you and I position us to be in this salvation? There is something to working out our salvation with fear and trembling, not working for it, but working it out. Again, I love the idea of Jesus Christ gives us a free pass. We didn't earn it. We received it by faith. He comes and says, hey, free eternal life on the top of the mountain. You can't get there by yourself, but I'm going to put you there on the top. And all you have to do is stay there until I come back. Are you in? If you choose to come back down, you chose to walk away. Jesus gave you a free lift ticket to the top of Mount Salvation. But you do have a part to play. You've got to stay there empowered by his grace. Go read the scriptures. I pray that the Lord Jesus Christ blesses you, continues to open your eyes, and that his grace is with you as you study this. If you have any questions, send me an email. And always remember, you shall know a tree by its fruit. When you're looking at people teaching the Word of God, when you're trying to decide or you're sharing this with your friends, and somebody's sharing with something with you that doesn't seem to fit with what you understand, look at the fruit. Does that person possess the fruit of the Spirit? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Is God using them to change other people's lives? And do you see good deeds in their life that would indicate the Spirit of Christ is in them? Never, ever take advice from somebody who doesn't exhibit the Spirit of Christ. Keep that in mind, and I will see you on the very next video.